Recorded Books presents All Shook Up by Shelley Pearsall, narrated by Pierce Cravens. Chapter 1. Welcome to My World. Looking back, I would say everything in my life changed the summer I turned 13 and my dad turned into Elvis. I'd heard people say 13 was an unlucky number, and from the very beginning, that seemed to be true. I'd been 13 for less than 24 hours when the phone call came from Florida about my grandma taking a fall on the steps of the Shadyside Episcopal Church and breaking her hip. That same day, somebody swiped my bike from the rack at the city pool because, yes, I'd stupidly left it unlocked. And then my mom decided to ship me off to Chicago for 4 months so she could rush to Florida to take care of my grandma. Before arriving in Illinois in August, I didn't know anything about my dad being Elvis. Well, that's not quite true. I knew there were people who pretended to be Elvis. You know, sideburns, sunglasses, twisting hips, jiggly legs and all. But I never thought my own dad would become one of them. Neither did my mother, or she probably wouldn't have put me on that plane. I'd have gone to Shadyside Villas instead, where I could have stayed with her and a lot of nice old people while we waited for Grandma's hip to recover. But my dad, in his usual style, didn't mention a word about Elvis when my mom called him. "Great, no problem. Sure, Josh can stay with me," he must have told her on the phone, while I stood on the other side of the kitchen doorway, crossing my fingers behind my back, whispering, "Say no," under my breath. As they were talking, I could hear my mom clattering a spoon around and around a mixing bowl, loudly making something for dinner. She never spoke to my father without sounding extremely busy. "So, you don't mind keeping Josh?" I heard her say. "Until Shirley's better? The doctors told me it could be a few months. He'll have to be enrolled in school. Are you sure this isn't going to be a problem?" Keep Josh. That phrase again. Like I was somebody's pet guinea pig or prized chihuahua getting passed back and forth. Keep Josh. Take Josh. Pick up Josh. Note to my parents, why not ask Josh what he would like to do? But after 8 years of being shipped between two houses almost 1,000 miles apart, I knew it was pretty much useless to say anything. I was the shared kid, and both of my parents liked me better if I seemed okay with their arrangement. So that's why I ended up telling my mom I was fine with living in Chicago for a while and staying with my dad, and even going to a different school. Although I wasn't really fine with any of those things. Especially not the new school. Chapter 2. Sideburns and Orange Parrots. My dad said he would meet me near the arrivals gate at the airport. The plane got there on time, I got there on time, my dad didn't. This wasn't any big surprise. Every year, I flew from Boston to Chicago to visit my father, usually during Christmas vacation and the last few weeks of August, and my dad had never once been in the right place at the right time. When I was younger, one of the flight attendants would bring me to airport security if my dad wasn't anywhere in sight when we landed. I was one of those crackling advertisements you always hear over the airport loudspeakers. "Mr. Denny, please meet your party at airport security. Crackle, crackle. Mr. Denny, please meet your..." That party was me. Back then, sitting around the security office wasn't so bad because they usually gave out free cookies and juice boxes to keep abandoned kids quiet and unpanicked. But I was 13 now, and I wasn't about to be treated like a lost kid in desperate need of a tropical fruit punch. So I didn't hang around by the gate. That was the trick, I had decided. Since I didn't need an airline babysitter anymore, I just tugged my carry-on bag over my shoulder and headed quickly for the baggage claims area, trying to look like I was somebody who traveled a lot and knew what he was doing. This time, Dad spotted me first. I was waiting for my suitcases to come around the baggage carousel when, out of the corner of my eye, I noticed this guy with strange black hair wildly waving his arms as he hurried toward me. Note, the last time I saw my dad's hair, it was brown. Light brown, and thinning a little on the top. Josh! Josh! Before I could say a word, I was wrapped up in one of Dad's garlic and cigarette smoke hugs. My dad works with smokers, and he eats out a lot, which you can tell just by getting close to him. He is also into big, manly hugs. This is the exact opposite of my mom and her family, who pat your back lightly and shake your hand when they meet you. Note to Dad, I prefer the way Mom acts. When my father finally stepped back and I got another look at him, I couldn't even think of what to say that would be polite or wouldn't hurt his feelings. He was wearing a blue Hawaiian shirt with orange parrots all over it, and jeans that were too tight for an adult, in my opinion, and scuffed, grass-stained white sneakers without socks. But it was his hair that I couldn't believe when I saw it up close. Remember, I didn't know anything about him being Elvis at this point. I couldn't tell if he was hoping to look younger or more in style or if he went to a discount haircutting place or what, but it was completely embarrassing to see what he'd done to himself. Picture a hairstyle that an outdated country western singer would wear. It was an extra shiny black color. Think jet black, or oil slick black, or overdid it with hair color for men black. And even worse, he had grown triangle-shaped sideburns down each cheek. They reached almost to the edge of his jaw. I'm being serious. And I swear it looked like maybe there was a little black eyeliner traced under his eyes, and I didn't even want to think about that. Jeesh. Your hair's different, I said, uncomfortably trying to avoid checking out his eyes again. Long story, he answered, draping one arm across my shoulders. I'll fill you in on all the details later. Let's get out of here. He started heading out of the baggage area. My car's in a no parking zone, probably covered in tickets by now. I got stuck in a traffic jam on the way here, and then when I got to the airport, I opened up my wallet and realized I didn't have one single dollar to pay the parking attendant. Not one stinking dollar, he repeated, giving me one of his goofy grins. Forgot to go to the bank yesterday, doesn't it figure? My dad squeezed my shoulders again. Oh, you're getting so daggone tall, Joshua Greenwood. Every time I see you, I swear I'm getting shorter. He says this every time I visit. If I hadn't reminded Dad about my luggage, we would have headed to the car without it. My mom is the exact opposite. She would have picked me up on time and had plenty of change for the parking attendant. And she would probably be carrying a post-it note that said, "Remember Josh's luggage." My mom is the post-it note queen. The dashboard of her car is always lined with little notes in various colors, like rows of international flags. Buy bread and eggs. Call dentist for Josh. Pick up new prescription. Cancel cable. Bring cookies to board meeting. Luggage, I said to my dad, jerking my thumb toward the baggage conveyor. Oh, right. That would help, wouldn't it? Dad laughed at himself. Because I was staying longer on this visit, I'd brought a lot more than usual. Dad tugged my suitcases off the conveyor belt one by one, and it took both of us to start pulling them down the corridor. Good movie title. Josh's Life in Three Suitcases and One Carry-On Bag. As we passed people who were hurrying to their flights, I couldn't shake the uncomfortable feeling that everybody who walked by us was noticing my dad. I caught people checking out the parrots and the sideburns and then pretending to look away before they started cracking up. And I could tell they were probably glancing back over their shoulders too, craning their necks like ostriches, once we'd gone by, just to get a second glimpse of the weird-looking country western guy with the fairly normal kid walking next to him. Why's that kid with that goofy guy? That's what they were probably thinking. Normally, I'm not the kind of person who spends a lot of time worrying about how I look, because there isn't a lot to pick on. My hair is nothing special, just short, a little wavy, and light brown. Like my dad's hair before the bad dye job. I don't have any of the big three yet. Zits, glasses, braces. My feet are on the larger side, but I'm one of those people who likes wearing my jeans long anyway. An inch dragging on the ground under my heels, getting frayed and worn, is perfect. It's a habit that drives my mom crazy. As more gawking people passed us, I could feel my face getting warm. Why had I worn one of my bright orange soccer sweatshirts? Why not dark blue, or better yet, gray? I reached up and flattened the hair across my forehead, hoping to cover up more of my face. I hadn't gotten a real haircut since the beginning of the summer, so this kind of worked. Keeping my eyes focused on the red and blue diamonds of the airport carpet, I imagined myself blending in the way lizards blend into trees. Then it happened. Two women walked by us, and I was jerked out of red and blue diamond land when I heard one of them say extra loudly to the other, "That guy looks just like Elvis! Look back at that guy in the Hawaiian shirt, Diane! Hurry before he gets too far ahead! Look!" But here's the part I couldn't believe. My dad turned around, waved at these two strange women, and said in a smooth southern drawl,
"Hey, darlings. You talking to the king?"
The suitcase I was pulling slammed right into the back of my ankles. Elvis. I'm just a hunk of burnin' love. Burnin' Love, 1972. Chapter 3. A Big Hunk of Love for Chicago. Trust me, right at that moment, I didn't really want an explanation for why my dad was pretending to be Elvis Presley, the king of rock and roll. If you have to choose between standing around with somebody who is being a complete hunka-hunka-burnin' shame in public or getting as far away from the situation as you can, you take the second option. Always. I started walking again. Fast. Trying to stay a good foot or two ahead of my dad. I didn't look back, even as he kept talking to me.
"Hey, Speedy Gonzalez," he hollered.
"I'm tired," I said over my shoulder.
"Well, then slow down a little.
I just want to get to the car." All the way there, I planned on how I was going to tell Dad that despite what he might think, I was not a dumb little kid anymore, and he'd better stop doing things that embarrassed me. I had a long list of examples. Embarrassing things my dad does. 1. Hums loudly in public places. 2. Wears sneakers without socks in the summer. Has hairy ankles. 3. Answers the phone too loudly or with some bizarre greeting other than hello, such as,
"Jerry's Pizza Shop, the Shoeshine Man,"
or
93.5 FM, you are on the Jerry Denny Show,
that sort of thing. 4. Puts his arm around my shoulders as if I'm still 5. 5. Introduces me to people as Joshua Aaron Greenwood, my son from Boston, which always leads to the usual divorce conversations. Why couldn't he just say, "This is Josh"? And I would also make sure he got the message that I didn't like his pretending to be Elvis act, or whatever he was doing to be funny this time. When we reached the car, it had a neon orange parking ticket stuck underneath the windshield wiper. Dad whipped the ticket off the windshield.
"Damn it, damn it, damn it."
Note, my dad tries his best not to swear when I'm visiting, but 99.9% of the time, he forgets. When he forgets, his swearing is one of the things I like about him. I tried to jam the suitcases into the back seat of his small car, which was already crowded with junk. He's driven the same dark blue Honda with the cat scratches on the trunk for as far back as I can remember.
"Just wedge your suitcase around whatever's sitting back there," my dad hollered.
Right, There were two big stereo speakers, wadded-up fast food wrappers, newspapers, a small lunch cooler, and about a dozen ceramic coffee mugs scattered across the floor of his back seat. I think you can tell a lot about people from their coffee mugs. For instance, on the floor of my dad's Honda, there was a gold-edged mug that said, "Top November Salesman, Murphy's Shoes." Others showed scenic places my dad had visited over the years, like Niagara Falls, St. Louis, and Myrtle Beach. One mug had the words, "Happy 40th Birthday," and another, "Coffee, Grounds for Divorce." I shoved that one farther under the backseat junk and climbed into the front. "All set?" My dad started the car, and Elvis's voice suddenly blasted out of the speakers, almost flattening us and half of O'Hare International Airport.
"Well, bless my soul, what's wrong with me?"
Letting out a string of swear words, Dad reached for the knobs, trying to find the volume. The air conditioner roared on instead.
"I'm itching like a man."
As the song boomed out of the speakers, he tried hitting several controls at once. All the people who were standing on the curb turned to stare at us, mouths open, and a ticket cop started walking slowly toward the car.
"I'm in love."
Oh, God. I slid down farther in my seat.
"I'm all shook up."
Right after that, the music cuts off, but I swear I could still hear "up, up, up" bouncing through the terminal and ricocheting off the windows.
"Sorry about that," Dad said, glancing nervously at me while the Honda lurched away from the curb,
with the entire city of Chicago watching us and shaking their heads. Freak family.
"Just listening to a few tunes on the way here," he added, as if that explained everything, as if every dad drove around Chicago with Elvis blasting out of his stereo. "It's a long drive, you know."
I leaned back in my seat and closed my eyes, giving Dad the big hint that I really didn't want to be around him right at the moment. And since I couldn't jump out of a moving vehicle headed on to the freeway at 50 miles per hour, closing my eyes was the best I could do. I thought about how things would have been completely different if I had gone to Florida with my mom. How, right then, we'd probably be eating at the little seafood place with those Sharks of the World paper placemats I liked to collect when I was younger. How we'd play cards at night on my grandma's patio with the moths smacking themselves silly against the screens. How there was fresh, squeezed orange juice in the morning. Note, I know this sounds like a dumb thing to feel nostalgic about, but trust me, orange juice tastes different in Florida. Next to me, I could hear Dad making all of his nervous sounds, tapping his fingers on the steering wheel and fiddling with the air conditioning.
"Josh,"
he said after it had been silent for about 5 seconds,
"there's something important I need to tell you about. Do you want to hear it now or later?"
I clenched my eyes tighter, pretending to be tired. "Later." Chapter 4. It's Now or Never. Later turned out to be the McDonald's where my dad stopped for a quick cup of coffee after borrowing $2 from me. We were sitting in a booth and I was rolling straw paper into little balls and putting them in a row like football linemen when my dad said in a completely calm voice,
"I didn't exactly know how to tell your mother this news when we talked before, but... well, I lost my job at the beginning of May."
What? I looked up from the table, totally shocked. Dad had worked as a salesman for Murphy's Shoes since he and my mom were together. The store's motto was, "In step with Chicago for over 30 years." I could still remember the sharp smell of leather and shoe polish when you opened the glass doors. Old stoop-backed Mr. Murphy, the owner, would always reach into the change cup on the counter and give me a nickel for the Chiclets gum machine by the front door.
"They were losing business," Dad continued, tracing his finger around the ridges of the coffee cup lid. What choice did they have? Eventually, they had to face the facts, and that meant closing the store and letting all of us go.
I stared, still in shock. The whole store is closed for good? Forever?
Yep.
What are you going to do? Have you got another job? Even as the words left my mouth, I knew this was a completely stupid question. Of course he didn't have another job yet. For years, all he had done was sell shoes. How many shoe salesman jobs were floating around out there in the world? I could picture my mom's expression when she eventually heard the news. Her lips would tighten into a disapproving line. She would take a deep, slow breath as if she was silently counting to 10. "It's always something," she would say finally, staring at the ceiling and sighing. "Always something with your father." Next, fill in the words, "And that's why we got divorced." Although my mom never spoke those words out loud, of course. The other unspoken words floating around in the air would be, "Please don't turn out like your dad." No chance. Dad moved his coffee cup to the side and rested his arms on the table.
"So here's the deal, Josh,"
he said, leaning forward and picking up one of the straw paper balls I'd made. He rolled it back and forth between his fingers.
"I entered this contest at the mall in June, an Elvis singing contest. I'd just lost my job at Murphy's a few weeks before, and I thought, what the hell?"
He glanced around and lowered his voice.
"Heck, I thought, what the heck have I got to lose? No job, nothing else to do, right? So, I paid the $10 contest fee, borrowed a black leather jacket from this friend of mine, got some of those stick-on sideburns, and went up there and sang my tail off."
He leaned closer as his voice fell to an excited whisper.
"I mean, I wasn't half bad, Josh. Really, I wasn't. People clapped, pretty hard for me at least, and one lady came running up to the stage and kissed me. I mean, I didn't even know this woman. She just wrapped her arms around me and planted one right..."
"Okay, Dad, I get it."
Jeesh, this was way more than I needed to know.
"Well, here's the thing," my dad continued. "I actually won the contest. Can you believe that? Jerry Denny, first place, $250.
He snapped his fingers together.
"Just like that, for singing one song, $250. That would have been 3 days of work at Murphy's. 3 days of lugging stacks of shoeboxes around and saying nice things about people's stinking feet. So," he said, leaning back and smiling, "what do you think?"
I wasn't sure what to think, except that I promised myself I would not set foot in Chicago's Summerlin Mall after hearing this story. All I could picture was my dad standing on the mall stage where they put Santa Claus every Christmas. My 40-year-old dad wearing somebody's black leather jacket and trying to twist his hips like Elvis. Oh, God, did he really twist his hips? And singing badly and getting kissed at the end by some wacko mall woman? And what if the purpose of the contest had been to get people to go on stage and make fools of themselves? There were contests like that. Did my dad realize that? Maybe the money and applause hadn't been for being the best, it had been for being Chicago's biggest joke. I glanced over at my dad's proud grin. Even the parrots on his shirt looked like they were stupidly smiling. A hollow feeling started burrowing a place in my stomach.
"I'm gonna get something to eat," I said, standing up suddenly. "I'm hungry." "Sure, sure."
Dad waved his hand toward the counter.
"Get yourself a snack. We'll have dinner later at home."
I took a long time to order. While I was standing there, I noticed an overweight, greasy-haired guy about my dad's age working at the takeout window, which made me think about my dad serving burgers and fries at McDonald's someday, if he couldn't find another shoe store job.
"Whenever you're ready,"
the counter girl kept saying.
giving me an annoyed look for taking up space. Even though McDonald's in Chicago are about the same as the ones in Boston, I stared at the menu choices like I was reading them for the first time. I couldn't seem to decide on anything. My mind jumped from one thought to the next. Elvis, my dad, Mr. Murphy's store closing, my mom in Florida, my grandma in the hospital with her broken hip, and my eyes kept moving back to the greasy-haired guy who was handing people's orders through the takeout window. How had he gotten there, I wondered. Did he go from selling sneakers to flipping burgers? The counter girl glared at me. Ready yet? Strawberry milkshake, I answered finally, even though I didn't really want a milkshake, and I never order strawberry. Chapter 5. Shaking Things Up. When I got back to the booth, my dad slid a small card across the table. Here, this is what I wanted you to see. Printed in gold letters on the white business card were the words, Jerry Denny as the King. For booking information, call. Below was my dad's phone number. Dad leaned back in the booth, smiling like he had just won the lottery or something. So, what's your reaction? To what? I replied, loudly squeaking my straw up and down in the milkshake cup, as if this would cover up the sound of what my dad was going to say next, which I had already guessed. About me being Elvis. You know, as a way to earn a living, just temporarily. I used to sing in that band in college when your mom and I were dating. I only gave it up when we moved here to Chicago, and I never got around to finding another band. I'm not that bad a singer. You've heard me before. Am I a bad singer? I've heard my dad sing in exactly three places: the car, birthday parties, and baseball games. He can sing the national anthem better and louder than most people, I've noticed. And he's the one who usually starts off happy birthday when nobody else wants to sing. But that doesn't make you Elvis. I've also seen a few out-of-focus pictures of my dad and his college band, the Fifth Street Players. Picture guys with really big 80s hair who look more like static electricity experiments than singers. Still, squeaking the straw up and down, I tried to figure out what to answer. I think people won't really get it. This was the nicest, vaguest advice I could come up with. They might think it's a little weird that you want to pretend to be Elvis, I added. As a job. A hurt look flickered across my father's face. Do you really think it's weird? I don't know why, but the fact that my dad didn't seem to have a clue about why this was a bad idea was beginning to bug me. How many adults did he see walking around with parrot shirts and triangle sideburns calling themselves the King? It's not exactly normal. The words came out of my mouth more sarcastically than I planned, and the parrot feathers looked ruffled as my dad stood up. That's okay. Everybody's entitled to their own opinion, I guess. Swiping his business card from the middle of the table and jamming it in the front pocket of his shirt, he kept on talking to me over his shoulder. I just thought you and I could have some fun with this idea while you were staying here. I figured maybe you'd want to help out at some of my gigs. You know, work the sound equipment or something. But if you aren't up for that, hey, it's your choice. You're getting old enough to make your own choices these days, I guess. He pushed open the door of the McDonald's with one hand. It swung back hard and smacked into mine as if my dad was saying, "Take that for hurting my feelings." Really, though? Help out at his gigs? I stared at the smirking parrots on my dad's back as we stepped out into the hot, blacktop sunshine. It would have been hysterical if it was a joke, and I knew if I called my buddy Brian in Boston and told him the whole story, he would probably fall off his pool deck laughing. I could hear his voice. You're freaking kidding me! No way! Your dad is doing what? But, of course, I would never tell something like that to Brian, or to any of my friends in Boston, for that matter. Once we got in the car, Dad pretended to ignore the topic of Elvis altogether. He turned the radio to the Chicago Cubs game. They were losing by 8 runs. Since I didn't know many of the Cubs players except for an outfielder who was traded from Boston, know that feeling, it was hard to make myself care. As the crowded neighborhoods and rusty factories of Chicago skimmed by the car windows, my dad tried to make conversation. He asked me about school and soccer and even, this was stretching it, the weather in Boston. I could tell he was trying hard to get back on the right foot with me after our bad start. Note, getting off on a bad start with each other is pretty normal for us. When we pulled up to my dad's house, it was the 7th inning stretch and the score was such a joke the announcers had stopped giving it. My dad flicked off the radio and pointed at the house and yard through the windshield. Notice anything different? At first, I didn't get what he was talking about. Things looked pretty much the same as always. My dad lives on a street called Oakmont in one of the older parts of Chicago. It's one of those city neighborhoods where all the houses look like they were made with the same house cookie cutter. The ones in his neighborhood are white bungalows with curved metal awnings over their small front porches. The awnings seem to come in one of 3 colors, black, green, or rusty white. A lot of the windows have awnings over them, too. It must be a Chicago thing. My dad's house is usually easy to spot because it's the one with the yard that looks most in need of mowing. Sometimes there are 1 or 2 leftover Christmas decorations still on display, like plastic candy canes or one of those mechanical reindeer with a head that goes up and down, even in August. But this time, I could see the Christmas decorations were gone, and the lawn was mowed in neat diagonal stripes, almost like a miniature baseball field. A basket of straggly purple flowers hung from the front porch.
Looks different, huh?
My dad nodded at the yard as we tugged the suitcases out of the car.
Been trying to find things to keep myself busy now that I'm home all day. Can't sit around doing nothing, you know?
When he pushed open the front door, a bleach-smelling tidal wave came rolling out, so I could tell that cleaning was one of the things he'd been doing.
Check out what's new in your bedroom, Dad said excitedly, pointing down the small hallway.
After seeing my bedroom, I could tell my dad was doing his best to be different, better on this visit. I wasn't sure if it was me turning 13 or what, but the embarrassing Empire Strikes Back bedspread that had been on the bed since I was about 7 was finally gone. May the force be with you, old bedspread, wherever you are. Above the bed, Dad had put up 2 new posters. They were those inspirational message-type ones, which I wasn't crazy about, but I didn't say anything. One had the word success, and the other, perseverance. The pictures on them weren't bad, though.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.